please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hi, welcome back. You're still watching Bazaar Morning Call. It's mildly in the green for now. The Nifty holding up with gains of about 30-odd points. Couple of stocks from the mid-cap IT space looking very good. Mastech has hit a new 52-week high today. That one's up almost about 5.5% to 6-odd percent. And volume's also piling up over there. Mastech should come up for you on your screen. But we also have the commodity space to deal with this morning. Lots happening in China, actually. Manisha Gupta joins in with a quick roundup of all that's happening there. Manisha.
Thank you so much for that, Sonia. Well, the markets do not like uncertainty. And looking at the kind of global scenario that we are in right now, it looks like an extended period of uncertainty that these markets will have to ready themselves with. So the crude oil prices are headed for a second weekly decline. We are trading at around 3-week lows onto this one. 4,000 has broken on the lower side. And the U.S. crude oil price is just about holding around that $60 per barrel mark. Of course, we have seen the U.S. supplies and output continue to increase. But the whole import tariff increase on steel is expected to impact the oil and gas as a sector as well, as they have been spending on infrastructure, on pipelines, etc. And that cost could go up is what is impacting this space. Even as the US dollar has been choppy and we have seen, we have seen the the Euro central bank statements come in case of the monetary tightening. This is one area which hasn't been able to take any of that support. You should have seen actually some safe haven buying with the kind of uncertainty that we are seeing in the global markets, but that's not happening. So we are looking at a 2-week close in case of the gold prices, and the silver prices have declined much faster, down by nearly 5% for the month of Feb, and March as well seems to be headed that way right now. The base metal prices, well, it's a third straight day that you have seen a decline come in for this one. Copper is headed for a third weekly decline. Aluminum prices are down by nearly 8% for this year now. We also have seen very sharp knockoff coming in for nickel prices. That one fell 2.5% overnight and has seen some more declines come in. The steel prices are down 5% in this week itself, and that seems to be impacting many of these steel ingredients. Markets really are awaiting on what kind of statements, retaliation, the stuff that the other countries would come in sense of the U.S. import tariffs. Until then, you are not looking at any buy calls coming in for this space. And add to that, while we are looking at correction, the volumes also have been on the higher side on the short part. So that tells you that there are more declines really coming in for the metal space for the very near term. Trading strategies, we have them from Com Trends, and they actually have come in for sell call for the metals and crude. They have a buy on gold, though. 30,600 is their target for today. But when it comes to metal, they have a sell on zinc. 207 is the target for on the lower side for that. Crude as well is a sell with 3880 per barrel for that one.
Okay. Thank you very much for that, Manisha. Well, as you point out, the Indian indices are also showing this metal softness, and the biggest loser is Tata Steel.
Oh, yes, it is. And in fact, now heading, at 626, so big downtake is what we have on Tata Steel right now. But HG Infra has seen a tepid listing, down about 6%. Here's more from the management.
So the debt as of 30th September was 350 crore. That is short and long, both. Out of this, 115 crore would be retired. And for the next year, we are not looking at further debt. So with that, the debt equity ratio would be in the range of 0.4-0.5%.
Okay. So if you talk about the projects, how many ongoing projects do you have at the moment? What is the value of your current order book? And just to put more filters to it, can you tell me what is the bifurcation between government orders and private orders as far as the current order book is concerned?
The unexecuted order book as of November, it is 3700 crores plus.
Okay.
And this is mainly, if you see, 70% of the projects are from the government and 30% is from two major clients like IRB and Tata.
Okay. In terms of margins, what kind of margins do you expect from the order book which you're holding at the moment?
See, the margins in the years, over the years, 7 years that we could have, that is a fairly good margin. We have increased consistently, and that improvement is could be seen the first 6 months of this particular financial year.
Right.
So we look ahead, that would be good for years to come.
Right. You've spoken about the financials. One question there. In the quarter gone by, what has been the revenue growth for the company, and how is the profitability shaped up? If you could throw some light on that, quarter three,
as well as say, obviously, in any of the highway sector company infrastructure, you had the last 6 months versus first 6 months.
Right.
So this third quarter has been quite good. And we look forward that whatever an executed order book that is 3700 crore is to be delivered within the next 2 years.
Okay. So just to compare the financials, and I'll be taking the case of FY16 versus FY17, your revenue grew somewhere around 36%, whereas your profitability, your bottom line grew over 63%. Help me understand, what is the kind of revenue and profitability growth do you expect in the current year, which is FY18, and for the next two financial years? What would be the bracket in which you expect your revenue and profitability to grow?
So in the last year, what has been our result, and the first 6 months has been significantly good. Okay. We could see those numbers.
Okay. So you expect to clock in over 36% as far as revenue and over 63% as far as PAT is concerned?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's after the listing. Just a mild premium was where it began, and now quoting at half at a 5% discount to the offer price. Anisha Jain, our expert on infra stocks, is with us. Anisha, can you just detail what are the company's EPC contracts, its strengths, its numbers?
Well, yes, I'll begin with valuations, if it's all right, Lata, because if you look at the benefit of this company was that the valuations were comfortable. In terms of now that it is listed at a discount, it seems that the valuation gap has rather increased because we have seen the run-up in the stocks like KNR, Dilip, etc., which are trading above 30 times the FY18 EPS. This now trades at around 24, 25 times, so that should be the benefit. Now, the reason it is getting a bit of discount because there are some risks with the business. Now, if you look at the past few years' performance, it has grown at around 30% CAGR when it comes to top line and bottom line, as Yash and the management were also talking about. But the track record has been really limited. The base was low, and that's why we saw the faster growth. The order book is 3,700 odd crores, but it's mainly limited. 80-85% of the business is limited in the states of Gujarat and Rajasthan, and that's the reason perhaps the stock has listed at a bit of discount. Back to you.
In the stock markets, but the Nifty Bank still in the red and the PSU index still in trouble. Quite clearly, the problem point for the economy itself appears to be the public sector banks. At CNBC TV18, we are looking at themes of revival of the PSU banks in our ongoing series, PSB 2.0. Is privatization the way ahead for PSU banks? On that theme, hear out Bimal Jalan, former governor, the Reserve Bank of India.
The main issue that we have to grapple with is that public sector banks, which are spread all over, decentralization. I mean, I am in favor of decentralization of the process. The government should decide on policy.
Okay.
I mean, that public sector banks or priority sector lending or what the interest rate should be and so on and so forth, that the Reserve Bank decides. The two combination, the Reserve Bank and the government.
Yeah.
I mean, they would decide what should be the policy, what should be the interest rate, what should be the outreach, and so on and so forth. But the governance part, that is how a public sector bank should be run, that must be delegated and decentralized to the and what you might say an autonomous agency. I mean, we have banking board bureau and so on and so forth. But I would say that what we need to do is, you think of public institutions like, say, UPSC.
Okay.
I mean, if you look at UPSC, if you look at the Election Commission, they are public institutions and they deliver. I mean, the largest free and fair elections in human history is delivered by Election Commission.
Absolutely.
If you look at all our IAS administrative system, it is through the UPSC. So what I'm saying is, essentially, I'm trying to emphasize, is and why, and you ask yourself the question, that why is it that we have institutions of this type, we have institutions of CAG type, and they function very well? Because they don't have to report to the ministry. But what they do, they are accountable to the parliament. So supposing now today, if you took a look at the public sector banks and you have a banking bureau, so you don't need a department of banking per se.
Do we need 70% of the banking sector to be dominated by these kind of banks? That is government-owned, majority government-owned banks. Should we look for a legislative change whereby the government owns a smaller number of banks and some of them the government allows its stake to fall below 50% so that what you exactly say, you know, administrative controls are reduced?
No, but I think you should, you have to first concentrate on the functioning of different public sector banks. I mean, supposing we have set up a public sector banks in an area where the amount of business is very small,
where the organization is very difficult to have with top class bankers and so on and so forth, then the best thing to do is to close that bank, for example, because it's non-functional. I'm just giving an example that if something is not functioning, if something is not delivering what you have set it up to do, then close it.
Okay. So you would go to the extent of closing down some of the public sector banks will not be a bad idea.
No. If they are non-functional, if they are making large losses, if the fiscal cost that you are incurring is much larger than the benefit that you are getting from having that particular bank, you can close it.